The Newsroom.
Good evening once again. It is still The Newsroom, and this is our segment, TNRXtra. Desire, Derek Ford Mogumisa is my name. We're going to be speaking to a gentleman that comes in from a company that is exciting so many youths down here in Kampala, probably in Uganda. We'll find out what their plans are at Uber. He is, of course, representing a company that many of us look at as a cab company. Are they a cab company? Are they a boda boda company? What exactly are they all about? I've been also told that even I, that is not into the transport business, could gain from Uber. That and much more we find out a little bit later. For now, though, let's get to some of that news around the world. And that news is news that should be so old, but I don't see it so much on my timeline. And I'm wondering why. Bud Spencer passed on Monday at the age of 86. Now, this is a gentleman that is, of course, well known for movies from the past, the Italian spaghettis, if we can get to call them that. Now, that death was, of course, confirmed by his family on Twitter, who came out to state, "With our deepest regrets, we have to tell you that Bud is flying to his next journey." Yeah, he's passed on. Of course, this is a legendary figure in the world of film, and may his soul rest in eternal peace. Maybe we can afford a minute of silence for him. Once again, may his soul rest in eternal peace. Now, tonight we talk Uber. It is a transport company that is at least some of the most accurate stuff I can come up about it as per now. For me, it has been something that I've heard about in the movies, in the series, and, well, a couple of cool people in outside countries talking about transportation. With me is a gentleman who, up until now, I know as Bertrand. Can we know you by a second name?
Sure. You can call me also Dennis if you want. That's my name.
Dennis.
Actually.
Yeah. All right, Dennis Bertrand.
Exactly.
Ugandan?
Not at all. I'm actually French,
okay,
but with Cameroonian origins.
All right, cool. Are you watching the Euros?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, and I'm reading for friends.
All right, definitely. Now, Uber, French company, American company, Icelandic company?
That's a good question. So Uber was actually co-founded by an American,
okay,
and a Canadian.
All right.
So they were actually on a trip in Paris in 2009. And they were out of a conference on tech, on startup and innovation. And they actually couldn't get a cab outside of the conference.
Mm.
And then one of the founders said, "Why can't I get just a driver just by pushing a button?"
Okay.
And then next thing you know, a year later, we started to have a first few vehicles in San Francisco,
mm-hmm,
in the United States. And now, today, we are actually over 460 cities and over 70 countries around. Pretty amazing story.
I can get a driver by a push of a button. How does that work? Do I have an application? Are there buttons set up in people's houses? What exactly is this?
So basically, Uber is a simple way to move around the city from point A to point B safely, reliably, and affordably. We basically offer a technology platform via mobile application,
mm-hmm,
where once you downloaded the Uber app on the Play Store or Google Play Store, you open it, you push a button, and then you get a driver within 3-4 minutes in Kampala and in
Entebbe.
It's actually an amazing way to move around. A lot of flexibility,
mm-hmm,
it's pretty amazing, and we're pretty excited.
Cool. So I push a button, I get a driver in 3 minutes or 4 minutes. Is this because you've hired this driver and they are there? When they rob me, I will come to Uber or something like that.
So right now, you didn't see any like big advertisement around it. We're going by word of mouth. So we reach out to a lot of special hires that we can see on stages in Kampala, and we told them, "Hey, we are coming in town, and we have this great, you know, income opportunity for you. A lot of efficiency that we can bring, and you know, yeah, just join. We want to be, you know, we want actually to involve, you know, local stakeholders and work with in collaboration with local drivers and partnerships." So a few started, and then they liked it, and then they're just now referring their friends and referring, you know, family and friends. And now, yes,
okay,
that's how we go around.
Did you do a feasibility study? I think you did not, because if you had, you would know that in Uganda, we don't use cabs. We love our boda-boda, we love our taxi. Cabs are for those that have an extra money to waste, not even spend. At least that is the stereotype we do have here. Why would you think you would have success in an environment like that?
Well, actually, Kampala is actually a growing city. In Uganda, a country that's also a fast-growing economy. What you see in Kampala, the people, the innovation, the entrepreneurship spirit, the actually, you know, all the that technology development that we see, we feel like that Uber can actually support that technology advancement that we see in Kampala, and we're pretty excited to actually be part of this growth in Kampala here for our service. So of course, Kampala is a natural fit for Uber to bring a service for all these reasons. What we're seeing here is we've seen that Kampala has a huge traffic congestion problem at some times and at some points. And we want and we aim to actually be part of the solution to improve it, to improve traffic congestion. How can we do around it? As you see today, an Uber can actually take 10, 12 passengers a day. So that means it's potentially
just one car.
One car. So it's potentially 10 or 12 cars that we take off the road if people are using, you know, Uber on a daily basis.
Yes.
And that's how we manage to actually reduce traffic congestion. So yes, so we're pretty excited to be here and pretty excited to actually be part of that solution.
Okay. What are the rates like? Are they more friendly than the old cab rates? You tell me that you've approached special hire drivers. Yeah. They had crazy rates. That's why I think many of us don't use them. So what are you telling them that will give them the prices that we find friendly enough?
So all rates are actually right now pretty competitive and compared to what people were used before. So we tell the drivers, you're probably going to make less on one trip, but we're going to bring you, now the business are going to, coming to you, we're going to bring you more volumes, and at the end of the day, you'll make more money than ever before.
Okay.
So, they of course, at the beginning, they were skeptical because they didn't believe like how many business and how many demand we could actually bring to them. Right now, we don't even do like any time of advertisement on TV, you don't see us on billboards. It's because the first few who tried it, tested it, they've seen the earnings just spike and increase, and now it's actually pretty amazing. So they are happy, we are happy, and the users are happy too, so it's amazing.
Cool. So for the person that didn't exactly get that explanation, yes, the cabs were expensive, that we did agree to. Okay. Uber comes and tells them, you know what, you know, they're expensive probably because he knows he's going to make two trips a day, so he'd better make a killing of those two trips. But now they're telling them, you're going to have many more trips, make it cheaper. Many more trips will come, and in the long run, you will make more money.
Exactly.
That is very genius. But how do I get to gain if I say, had a car, but I cannot leave office? Can I gain out of this beautiful, seemingly beautiful Uber experience?
So if you have your car and you're going to office, for example, instead of just having your car at idle, well, you know, put your car on Uber platform, get a driver, and, you know, just earn out of it.
So I get my driver?
Yeah.
Give them my car.
Exactly.
I drive to work, and they just roam around the town, make a couple of dimes, pick me in the evening, I go home.
Exactly. That's a great way also, definitely, to actually earn from your vehicle.
Interesting. Security then, because many Ugandans are worried about their security. They would want to know, if I say, send my luggage, I'm at work, I bought some items, they have arrived, I cannot drive them home. So I call an Uber, take this to my place, wherever, and then they don't get there safe. Who do I talk to?
Yes, so definitely, safety is actually at the center of our focus of the Uber experience. Safety for riders and safety for drivers. So our technology, we're pretty excited about it because it enables us to actually provide safety measures before the trip, during the trip, and after the trip. Let me elaborate on this. So we actually ensure safety of riders before the trip through actually three features. The first one you have to know is that now, because you can get a ride just by opening an app and pushing a button, there is no more hailing on the street. So at night, late at night, for example, you come out of a restaurant or bar or club, you don't have to walk in the streets when it's dark you stay, you know, in a safe place. You just open your app, push a button, and then within 3-4 minutes, you get a driver. So it's actually safer for that. The other features before the trip is that you can know that when you use the Uber platform, there is no discrimination. No discrimination based on your ethnicity, based on your gender, based on the trip distance. You know that your request will actually be transferred to the closest driver. And for you, it's actually another advantage. The third one, I would say, is that the trips, they're not anonymous anymore. Before, you would go to a stage and you don't even know who's necessarily the driver or anything. On the Uber platform, when you request your trip, you actually have the name of the driver, the picture of the driver, the information about the vehicles, so you can actually have some kind of details about the driver, which actually make it safer for you, for users.
Yes.
Now, if you talk about the on the trip, during the trip, we ensure safety of riders by actually two main features. The first one we have, and I think that's one of people will be most excited about, is you can actually, on an Uber, share your trip details with family and friends. Example, it's late at night, you don't feel necessarily safe where you are, you get on an Uber, and you're like, well, let me share my trip details with my, with my friends and family. For women, they can I want to share my trip details with my husband, for example. So she will send you through the app a link of the trip, and you will be able to see real-time the vehicle move on a map, so you can actually see where the vehicle is. That's an excellent feature for people on the trip.
My dating friends will love that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Definitely. I mean, it's pretty amazing. And if you've seen, even for parents, for kids that are in vehicle, they want to monitor what the kid is exactly. The other one we have is actually about, the app is actually linked to GPS services such as Google Map or Waze. So now you can be sure that, hey, my driver is not going around or taking a long route or something like that. He's going actually in the right direction. I want him to
go. So it is okay for the person who does not know where they are going, but they've just been given directions or maybe just maps, so they know where exactly they are going, and the driver is not taking advantage of them.
Exactly. And the riders can actually put in the app the drop-off location, so that the drivers know exactly where the user wants to be dropped off at.
Cool. Now, for the person that is interested in joining this, I'm just going to ask two questions. Yeah. First of those is this just for cars? Can it be for bikes too?
So for now, it's only with drivers. We're going to see next projects we're going to launch. For now, it's actually for passengers, cars, and 6 to 7 passenger cars. These are the type of cars we accept on the platform.
That is 6 passenger cars?
Yeah. Up to 6-7 passenger cars.
Okay, so my 4 passenger car cannot.
Yes.
Oh, it
so
can.
We have 2. Yeah, saloon cars.
All right.
And 6 and 7 passenger cars.
All right.
What we see in other part of the world, we see here that Kampala is actually kind of the capital of Bola Bolas.
Yes. In East Africa. In the world, I think. I'm not so sure there is.
And probably in the world. We've seen in Asia, we have a product for that, like Uber Moto, that we launched in Asia. And definitely, we're actually looking into that product here and see, I think we have an opportunity here, and we're still studying.
Okay, interesting. Brings me to the next question.
Sure.
Some of us are just starting out. We're young people. Yeah. We get our first salary, and first thing we think of, let me run to the bank, get a loan, probably 4 million shillings, buy a probable 8th-hand car.
Okay.
Can that still qualify for Uber?
So a high-end car, you mean?
No, 8th-hand, I mean someone bought it in 2000, sold it in 2002, and I'm buying it's a bit crickety, it's old.
So of course what we want is safety for users.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, we're going to inspect the vehicle and make sure it's in a good condition and it's a good quality car.
So you have people who inspect it first.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's not about me, oh, I downloaded an Uber app, so I'll just sign up as a driver. This car has to physically be...
Exactly. So for the drivers, so another feature here, we get back on safety. On the back end, what we do, every driver that comes to us to drive on the Uber platform undergoes a rigorous screening process. So we verify the crime record of the driver and make sure that the crime record is actually clean. So before we activate them. So it's you cannot just come on your platform and be like, hey, I want to be activated. No, we have to actually verify all these things. You have to have training after that.
And after that, we have also to check your vehicle and make sure you inspect it. Your vehicle needs to actually have and follow like the required licensing process. So I have a KCC permit, I have a vehicle insurance with third party coverage. So yes, so there are a set of criteria that, that we set and we like to raise the bar.
Do you have success stories? I mean, people who've come out and said, I have become a millionaire or I've become richer than I was in a job out of Uber.
So we definitely have a lot of success stories, especially in sub-Saharan Africa. Because we bring more efficiencies, it's a lot of income opportunities that we bring on the table. One of the currently one of the most successful is we have here in Uganda.
In Uganda already.
In Uganda already, we actually activated our first deaf partners. So and he's so excited about this opportunity. Like for him, it's a new way to earn on the Uber platform. Okay. And those these little success stories will just multiply. And we'll have people that after that, you know, they offer for now just a vehicle, you know, the markets are Nairobi. Now, people who started at the beginning with just one vehicles were now able to buy a fleet of vehicles and then employ new people.
And they'll still put them on Uber.
Exactly. And then employ new people, provide new jobs for other people. And these people will also, at one point, have enough money to buy their own vehicle, et cetera, et cetera.
Right. On
so
the
it's
ground.
A great already, yeah.
Interesting. On the ground, we do have a lot of people who are struggling with taxi licenses. They have taxis, the matatus,
yes.
The vans and all. Well, this could be a new platform for them to actually get to move into, which is a very beautiful one, I've got to say.
Yeah, for now, we're not into matatus, but yeah, so now it's like...
So they'll have to sell and buy smaller cars.
Exactly.
All right, interesting. Now, a quick question. Yes. The person at home might be wondering...
Yes.
Is there a standard price for, say, Vision Group 2 Serena Hotel?
So how do we price?
Yes.
Okay, so our pricing is like in three parts. The first part is a base fare of 1,300
shillings. 1,300
shillings, that's a base fare.
Okay.
Plus we charge per minute, 200 shillings per minute.
Okay.
Plus 900 shillings per kilometer. So it's actually a pretty aggressive pricing and pretty affordable.
1,300 is the base. Someone help me.
For example, if you were to go from New Vision here to Serena,
that's about how many kilometers?
Assuming no traffic, that's a good question. How many kilometers is?
Let's go with 3 kilometers.
Yeah, a 3 kilometers. Well,
that's on the high end.
Yeah, that's on the high end. Yes, you would pay something with no traffic. We're talking about no traffic here.
Yeah, no traffic. That should be about 5 minutes.
Yeah. So,
okay.
So you would pay. I would say 6,000-7,000, which is not much.
And wow, that's with all that comfort. I think a bike is about 4,000.
Yeah.
So 2,000 more and you're in the comfort of a car.
3,000 more without traffic. Of course, if there is traffic, of course it's going to be a bit more expensive.
Because the minutes will be longer.
Exactly, it will be longer.
Interesting.
So I mean, it's yeah.
All right. We'll wish you all the best and I hope you will be back here to tell us more of those success stories of Uber down here in Uganda. And of course, we shall be expecting some business, huh? All right.
Thank you very much, Jose.
That was Dennis Bertrand. At least those are the names that he did get to give us. Of course, getting to tell us more about Uber. My name is Desire Derek Ford Mogumisa. And all I can say is thank you so much for having been a part of the package that was TNR tonight. Have yourselves a great evening. We never say good night, so I will not. Enjoy the programming.